Welcome, everyone. My name is Sarah Ray from the Bloomfield Public Library. Thank you for joining us for part two of Berlioz and Opera. I'm going to turn this over to Jeffrey to get us started.
Oh, thank you, Sarah. And, well, welcome to Berlioz part two. I'll leave off half the title. For those who may not have tuned into the first presentation, I was trying to show how Berlioz sounded like no one before him and no one during his time, and I used a quote from Bernie Holland, former critic of the New York Times, which is the following, that it seems that Hector Berlioz arrived on planet Earth by spaceship and departed the same way. So the second part of this would be that his music really had no influence on subsequent composers. Nobody tried to sound like Berlioz. Now, originally my idea was to go to his first performed opera. If you recall, back in September, we did his first completed opera, which never got a performance, and then he took it apart, kept the overture, may have used a couple of fragments for other works. But we no longer have the score. So I was going to do Benvenuto Cellini. But then I was giving this some more thought, and I found it very difficult not to include the Symphonie Fantastique, even though it is not an opera. In fact, it's the most operatic, unoperatic work I can think of. Now, in an opera, you need singers to convey passions and emotions, keep the storyline going. You might have a chorus, might be a ballet, which usually you don't need. The French always wanted to have a ballet in the opera. These are elements that the Symphonie Fantastique don't have, but it does have a program. Berlioz wrote out a scenario, five parts, so we have five movements to the symphony. And instead of using singers, he's using the instruments of the orchestra to act as singers, to act out the parts. This work is very descriptive, down to the slightest detail, as you'll see a little bit later on. And I thought we should delve into it, and because it is a major work, and in terms of its first performance on December 5th of 1830, this was a musical bomb, an explosion. This was so unlike anything the Parisian public had heard. They had heard some Berlioz before. There were some nine concerts that either were entirely devoted to his music or had single works by him on it. So it's not as if the general public was unaware of him completely. It was still not a household name. But he really made a name for himself with this program on the 5th, which was almost entirely his own music. Now, what is a bit bizarre about this work is that it was the result of a relationship with a woman that he never had. And he was suffering for some 2.5 years from unrequited love, did everything possible to meet this woman, failed miserably, and it took falling in love with someone else after nearly 2.5 years of pursuit to get him out of this love. But the only real way to get out of it was to exorcise her from his system and to write a symphony about it. And that's what the Symphonie Fantastique is about. It's not just a symphony. It's what we call a programmatic symphony. It has a detailed program. And this was intentional. Berlioz wanted everybody to know this. He wrote the program out. In May of 1830, he had it published in two Parisian newspapers. He had it published again after some revisions a couple days before the performance. And in fact, it's because of the printed program in the papers that Franz Liszt came to know Berlioz. Liszt read about the program, thought this sounded really wacky and right up his alley, and the night before the premiere, went to Berlioz's apartment to meet him. Extraordinary, 19-year-old Franz Liszt, already one of the great pianists of Europe, knocking on Berlioz's door. Berlioz opens it, and there is this extraordinary figure. And they sit down and chat, get on very well. And this begins an over 20-year, very, very close relationship. And Liszt, in fact, will help Berlioz, will publish a piano score, pay for it from his own pocket, of the Symphonie Fantastique, which will lead it to become known outside of France. So who is this mysterious woman? Well, her name was Harriet Smithson, was an Irish actress, was born 1800, dies in 1854. Berlioz, by the way, for the newcomers, born in 1803, dies in 1869. And she came from a very low-class Irish acting family, and makes her debut on the Dublin stage at the age of 15, and at age 18, debuts in London. Never had much of a career in England. It might have been due to her very strong Irish accent, and I guess she wasn't willing to tune it down or sound more English. And it also seems that she had a rather small voice, didn't project very well. Now, in 1827, she comes to Paris with a troupe of some 25 English actors and actresses, and they're going to perform Shakespeare in English in Paris. Now, this is not the first time this happens. In 1822, we had another group of English actors, again, performing in English, but this was bad timing. There were still very, ruffled feelings because of Waterloo and the defeat by the English. And these poor actors and actresses were bombarded with vegetables and anything that was handy. Police had to be called in, performances were canceled. But 5 years later, a complete change. Suddenly, anything English is in, is fashionable. And people are buying English soap and English lotions and English beer. And so this is the perfect time to come and perform Shakespeare. Also keep in mind, and this is a subject for some other time, Shakespeare in the 1820s was not the household name that he is today. He'd been pretty much dormant for two centuries after his death. And it's at the beginning of Romanticism that the early Romantics discover Shakespeare, and we're having translations of Shakespeare into German, into French, into Italian, good translations. And then this is a great discovery, and he's going to be one of the great idols of the early Romantics. So in 1827, he's going to be performed, Romeo and Juliet and Hamlet, at the Théâtre de l'Odéon. I don't know if you know this theater in Paris. It has a monumental, wonderful neoclassical facade. And they're going to perform also some English works, Richard Sheridan plays, etc. And all the young Romantics are going to come to these performances. Victor Hugo, Alexandre Dumas, Eugène Delacroix, the painter, Berlioz, of course. Other names that you might not know, but who were very important in the early Romantic movement. And they're all knocked off their pedestals seeing this. Now, most of them didn't speak English or understand English, so there were programs that had on one side the English text, and on the other side a very loose, rough translation. Nobody was more affected by this than Berlioz. And there's a French word called coup de foudre, which means sort of love at first sight, I guess, or being thunderstruck. And Berlioz had a double coup de foudre, or a double coup de foudre. One was Shakespeare. He did not know Shakespeare before this. And Shakespeare, along with Goethe, would be really two of the great authors, most influential. I left out also Virgil, the Roman poet. Throughout his life. So that's the coup de foudre number one. Number two is he falls in love with the actress portraying Ophelia in Hamlet and portraying Juliet in Romeo and Juliet. And this is September 11th of 1827, and for nearly 2.5 years he's going to pursue her, and he becomes obsessed with her. Oh, he's a student at the conservatoire. He's supposed to be working and composing. He can't do it. He can't sleep at night. He'll get up in the middle of the night, walk down to the theater, and strut up and down the colonnade, thinking about her, trying to visualize her. Sometimes he'll go for long walks outside of Paris. At that time, Montmartre wasn't part of Paris. He'd walk up to Montmartre, or he'd go into the countryside, exhaust himself, and just simply collapse and fall asleep there where he was, in the bushes someplace. He tries to meet her. He writes passionate love letters to her. She's scared out of her mind. She thinks he's a lunatic. He tries to see her, trying to bribe the concierge, who won't let him in. He'll stand by the entrance to the theater and wait to catch a glimpse of her. He does manage to sort of get to know her manager, but the manager simply writes back to him, "She cannot reciprocate your feelings." At one point, he rents rooms right opposite where she is residing, so that he can watch her come and go from her apartment. And it gets so intense that at one moment she leaves Paris, goes back to London for a spell, and he rents her rooms just so he can take in her, what's the right word, smells or odors. So none of this is getting him anywhere. And he thinks, well, maybe if I organize a concert, she'll come to the concert and she'll take an interest, or better than that, fall in love with me. So he does organize a concert. It's in May of 1828, and he's going to rent the Salle du Conservatoire, which is where this December 5th concert will take place. A beautiful hall in Paris, still exists today. It was constructed or opened in 1811. Rather small, only seats 1,100 people. And it'll be an important hall for Berlioz because it'll have a regular audience, not for Berlioz, but for an orchestra, which I'll mention a little later. And this will help with attendance for his first concerts there. But back in 1828, he's still relatively unknown. He asks a friend of his, Nathan Bloch, B-L-O-C, and the first name would be Nathan in English, who he'd known from the Théâtre de l'Odéon, and even better, from the Théâtre des Nouveautés, that theater opening in 1827, and Bloch was its conductor, and Berlioz would actually sing in the chorus for several months to scrape up a little extra money. And unfortunately, he programs it, and I don't think it was his fault. He wasn't a fool, but it was programmed on Pentecost, or Pentecôte weekend. And that's a weekend, and still today, where all of Paris leaves and goes to the country. So the chances of having a full house were not good, and the press would report half the hall was empty. Berlioz would say three-quarters was full. But at least it did get him to become a little bit better known to the musical society in Paris, because you had some reputable people in the audience, like Aubert, the opera composer, François Abenecker, important figure in the early years of Berlioz, not a great supporter of his, but Abenecker, who was the director of l'opéra and the founder of an important orchestra, would give the premiere of the Symphonie Fantastique, as well as the ill-fated opera Benvenuto Cellini. Oh, maybe a few words about Abenecker while we're there. He's born in 1781 in northeastern France, near the Belgian border in Mézières-Charleville. And he was an excellent violinist and a very important conductor. He's one of these figures who fall by the wayside in music history because he wasn't a composer. Yes, he wrote a couple of works for violin. No one's ever plays them, and they certainly haven't been recorded. Nobody wants to. He wasn't a composer. He was a violinist. He was a conductor. And he would conduct the opera, would be its primary conductor from 1826 till 1848, which means he would conduct the premieres of several very important operas. Guillaume Tell, William Tell by Rossini in 1829. The first two French operas by Giacomo Meyerbeer, Robert le Diable in 1831, and Les Huguenots, better known, in 1836, and also La Juive of 1835. Now, he was also a passionate lover of Beethoven's music at a time when Beethoven wasn't known in Paris. Now, Beethoven, to get our chronologies right, it's one thing I've noticed about Jeopardy. I saw this the other night on television, is that these people have an incredible amount of factual knowledge, but they have no sense of chronology. And they put people in the 18th century in the 16th century and people of the 16th century in the 19th century. So chronology is important. Beethoven is born in 1770, dies in 1827, 3 years before the Symphonie Fantastique. His first symphony dates from 1800, but it's not traveling to France, nor will his subsequent symphonies, except for Abnak. Now, he's going to conduct a student orchestra at the Conservatoire and give the first performance of a Beethoven symphony in 1807, Symphony No. 1, and not well appreciated by the public. And so he doesn't try until again in 1811 with the second symphony and the third. Once again, reaction is very negative. Now he waits till 1818. He becomes in charge of a concert series, not a symphonic orchestra, but a series of concerts that would take place every year, the Concert Spirituel. And it was to replace operas and dramatic spectacles, which were closed down during religious holidays, particularly before Easter, Lent, etc. And these concerts date back to 1725. And at one of these concerts in 1818, he tries the Eroica again. Once again, thumbs down by the public. So it's in 1826, he decides to invite some musicians to his house for lunch. And I saw the names, they're 27, no less than 27. These are the top players in Paris. They played in the opera orchestra. Most of them had their premier prix, their first prizes, the highest level you could attain at the Conservatoire. Invites them for lunch, but he says, bring along your instruments. And when they come to his house, they discover music stands with the parts of the Eroica Symphony on them. And he says, hey, before we have something to eat, why don't we sit down and read through this? And for France, this is very dangerous because the number one priority in France is food. Everything comes next. So not to feed your troops first and then have them play, I think was very risky. But it seemed to work. At first, they didn't care for the music. But the more they rehearsed, the more they did like it. And after 4 hours, so around 4 o'clock, finally, Madame Abneck offered them something to eat. And they continued to rehearse during the next 2 years. And they would rehearse other symphonies by Beethoven. And Abneck developed a really very good ensemble of players. So that in early 1828, he's going to approach the director of the Conservatoire, Luigi Cherubini, and suggest to him the formation of a permanent orchestra that would perform in the Salle du Conservatoire. Cherubini liked the idea, got permission from the Ministry of Arts, that was the ultimate control of the hall. And we have the first concert of La Société des Concerts du Conservatoire on March 9th of 1828. Now, this is an orchestra that still exists today, but under a different name, 1967, change of administration and a new name, and now it's known as L'Orchestre de Paris. At that time in 67, Herbert von Karajan was invited to be its permanent conductor, later Sir Georg Scholte. And it's one of the early orchestras, and really good orchestras, that still exists today. You can look at the Gewandhaus in Leipzig, which was established in 1781. And then you have the Philharmonic Society in London in 1813. And all the top conductors wanted to come and conduct it. So it must have been of a high level. Mendelssohn goes there. Berlioz conducts the Philharmonic Society. Louis Spohr was an important early conductor. And after that, it's the Vienna Philharmonic in 1842, the Berlin Philharmonic in 1882. And Concertgebouw in 1888, and I think those are really your top orchestras in existence today. So they all have long histories, and La Société, one of the oldest histories. Now, there was a problem with this orchestra. They didn't give a lot of concerts. They had an annual series of 6 concerts, and they might give 1 or 2 extra concerts, benefit or charity performances. And so good was the orchestra that it was impossible to get tickets. You would get a subscription if you were lucky, and you would keep it for your lifetime, and you would put it in your will. It's kind of like getting season tickets for Giants games at the Meadowlands. These subscriptions are very, very valued, and you pass them down to your family members. The same with the Société des Concerts. Wagner managed to get in 1839, and he was one of those who attested to the fact that this was one of the best orchestras in Europe, if not the best. And Abneck was still its conductor at that point. Now, the only disadvantage was that it was a Beethoven orchestra. It specialized in playing the symphonies, the concerti, his overtures, even sometimes orchestrating his chamber works. So to give you an example, from 1828 to 1837, you had 68 performances of Beethoven's symphonies. This is colossal in comparison to 5 for Mozart and 7 for Haydn. We're just talking about symphonies. I'm not talking about the concerti or the overtures or anything else by Beethoven. Are they playing French music? No. There's maybe one composer who occasionally would get a symphony performed, and he wasn't even noted as a symphonic composer, and that's Georges Onslow. He wrote mainly chamber music. But you do see, once in a while, a symphony. He wrote 4 on their programs. Berlioz, during this 10-year period when he was very productive, got heard once, just an overture. And during his whole lifetime, was only performed twice with the Société. It would take later orchestras, the orchestras in the, well, there's Concert Padlu in the early 1860s, Concert Colonne, the early 70s, and Concert Colonne, which was very instrumental in the revived, renewed interest in Berlioz, who by that point, after his death, was relatively forgotten, and then the Concert L'Amoureux in the early 1880s. Those orchestras would play music by a new generation of French symphonic composers. And you have to add to this that first half of the 19th century, aside from Berlioz, most composers in France were writing operas. They weren't interested in symphonies, concerti, and chamber music. And it's Saint-Saëns who was really one of the first to write symphonies and concerti and chamber music, which would influence others, César Franck, Bizet, Lalo. And it's those composers who are going to be heard mainly on the programs of those other 3 orchestras known as les associations. So what's important here is that you had a ready-made audience for your music if you were Berlioz, because these people were so used to coming to hear Beethoven in this wonderful Salle du Conservatoire, which had a great acoustic, that Berlioz could count on a number of them coming to hear his own music. They were curious. So anyway, we digress there terribly. We go back to Harriet Smithson and Berlioz. And this is getting nowhere. He does a second attempt to woo her to the concert hall. Of course, she did not attend that concert of May of 1828. And he tries again when he hears that she's going to give a charity performance at the Opera Comique. She's going to perform scenes from Romeo and Juliet. Now, she didn't speak French. Berlioz at this point was taking English lessons, and eventually he could read it very well. I get different reports on how well he spoke it, but he certainly could understand English. And some of these letters might have been in English to her. At this point, she's refusing all letters from him. She's told her concierge and her servants, don't even hand them to me. And he decides that he's going to try and get a composition of his own on this program. Now, she had caused quite a sensation in Paris, unlike, well, as she hadn't in England, in that the French were used to a very conservative style of acting. Very few movements, no expression of emotion, you're really just declaiming. And along she comes, and she was quite attractive, and she was quite hysterical on stage. She's shrieking, she's crying, she's ripping up the scenery. Parisians had never seen anything like this before, and she takes Paris by storm. And so she was certain of having a good audience. Now, with this benefit performance, there was a rehearsal that Berlioz would attend, and she was on stage with her Romeo and apparently in his arms, and Berlioz walks into the auditorium, sees her in the arms of another man, an actor, shrieks and goes running out of the auditorium. And she knew exactly who it was. She even turned around to her colleagues and said, "That is the man whose eyes bode no good," was her quote. And Berlioz, in his very strange mind at this point, thought, well, if I can get one of my overtures performed on the program, she'll be in the hall and she'll hear it. Well, he does get his overture Waverly performed at the beginning of the evening, but she's not in the hall. She's in her dressing room getting ready for her performance. So she doesn't hear it. Nor did she, I can't remember I said, she did not attend the May concert of 1828. So this continues on until the end of 1829 in December or early January of 1830. And Berlioz takes on a job giving guitar lessons in a boarding school in the Marais. It was run by a Madame Aubry. And also there was a young pianist, she was only 19, by name of Camille Moquet. And they start to talk, and Berlioz was very open about his passion for Harriet. I mean, he's told everybody he knew in Paris. All the musical community in Paris knew about it. And so he says the same to Camille. And she thinks to herself, wouldn't it be kind of fun to get him to fall in love with me and forget Harriet? And she spreads lies about Harriet, that Harriet has been sleeping with her manager, has been unfaithful and this and that. Which, of course, weren't true. And she slowly gets Berlioz off of Harriet, and he does fall in love with Camille, and that's a whole another story. But before he can truly give himself to Camille, he has to exorcise Harriet from his system, and that would be the Symphonie Fantastique. And he's going to compose this rather quickly, sometime between January and May of 1830. It's a monumental work. It's over 50 minutes long. And as I said, he writes out this program, the scenario. And that first printing comes in May. And he subtitles it, it's Symphonie Fantastique, Fantastical Symphony, subtitled Episode in the Life of an Artist. And it's the first autobiographical work in music history. And it's about him and, of course, his passion for Harriet Smithson, who becomes known as the Beloved. And in the first movement, which is just Passions and Reveries, it's a reflection of his unrequited love for her, particularly after he has taken an overdose of opium. Again, this is in the plot. Berlioz doesn't do this. And he was not, if somebody asked me afterwards, he was not addicted to opium. He would take it later in life to take some of the pain out of his many maladies that he had. But he wasn't really addicted to it. Anyway, this young artist takes an overdose and, as I say, hallucinates a five-movement symphony. Now, there are many aspects of this symphony that are new and different and must have been, aside from intriguing, quite shocking to the audiences of 1830. And one of them is what Berlioz termed the idée fixe, or obsession, and this actually, after Berlioz, became a part of French vocabulary. And it's a tune that is recurrent, and it represents the Beloved, or Harriet. This might sound familiar because this is the forerunner of the leitmotif, so connected with Wagner. Wagner takes it to different levels. Berlioz only has the one theme in the Symphonie Fantastique, but he transforms it so that it fits in with the mood of each movement, and each movement is quite different. So I want to give you an example. Play you the theme and then show you how it is going to be changing with each movement. So if you'll give me 1 second to, as they call, skate to get to the theme. And we're almost there. And there. Okay. All right, well, slight introduction, and then you'll hear the theme. And then afterwards, I'll play it a second time. I'll play the beginning of the symphony up to the end of the theme. And then we'll go on to the second movement, and you'll hear how he changes it. Your theme, and it will be in each movement, but sometimes disguised. It might even have difficulties recognizing it, particularly in the last movement where it completely distorts the theme. So I'm going to start from the beginning of the movement. You get to hear it a second of time. In the second movement, it'll be in the same version, but it's later on it's going to change a bit. So here's the beginning of the first movement.
Thank you.
the theme a second time. Try to keep that in your mind as we listen to the second movement, which is just at a ball. And you have the young artist who sees his beloved dancing. So what Berlioz does is take the theme, and whereas in the first movement you're in the tempo or the time of 4-4, common time, now you're in a waltz tempo, and he's going to turn the theme into a waltz. And you'll hear this 2 minutes in, first played by the flute and the oboe. Then it appears again towards the end. I think it's with the clarinet.
Thank you.
Now, the third movement we're going to have to skip over, and it's an example, though, of some of the innovations that Berlioz introduces into orchestration. Third is simply the artist walking through the countryside, and he hears two shepherds playing their horns, sort of in different valleys. They're communicating with each other. So for one of the shepherd's horn, you've got the oboe, and the other, you've got the English horn. English horn is not a part of the orchestra at this point. This is new. And so in essence, you have a duet between these two instruments. This has never been done before. And at the very end, you have the theme of Harriet unchanged, or the beloved, just so you know that the artist is thinking of her. And it ends with the oboe being accompanied only by four kettle drums or timpani. Again, unheard of. Normally in an orchestra, you have one or two at this point. Now you've got four. They can actually play a chord together. They're tuned differently. So quite original. Now it's the fourth movement where things start to get interesting. And before I play it, I want to play the third movement of a Beethoven symphony. It's symphony number one. When we did this a month ago, you remember, I played you a number of overtures to compare them with the Berlioz overture, Les Frangeuses. And these were overtures that were written at just about the same time to show you what a contrast or what a change we have with the Berlioz work in comparison with the other three. And again, going back to this quote and where the heck did this music come from? I want to do the same with this Beethoven symphony. The fourth movement of the Symphonie Fantastique is the equivalent of a minuet or scherzo in a classical early romantic symphony. This is Beethoven Symphony number 1. He calls it a minuetto, but this is nothing like a minuetto. This is already a scherzo, but it doesn't call the third movement a scherzo until the second symphony. But I'm playing it so that you as an audience, can imagine the audience of 1830, what it's used to hearing. It's accustomed to Beethoven, who at this point was still considered avant-garde. But then along comes Berlioz, and we have the super, super avant-garde. And you can just imagine what the reaction must have been of the audience to hearing this music. So listen to the Beethoven, and then I'll just say a few brief words about what the fourth movement is about. Thank you. that's what the audience was accustomed to hearing. And that takes us to the fourth movement, which must have been a shocker back then, not only the program, but the music itself. I think I'll read you, it's very brief, the text of the program. The fourth movement, the artist dreams that he murdered his beloved and that he has been condemned to death and is being led to execution. A march that is alternately somber and wild, brilliant and solemn, accompanies the procession. The tumultuous outbursts are followed without modulation by measured steps. At last, the fixed idea returns for a moment. A last thought of love is revived, which is cut short by the death blow. So you've got this young artist being marched to the guillotine, and this music is extremely graphic. You will hear the theme of the beloved. It's the last thing he hears. Then you hear the crashing of the guillotine blade coming down. And listen carefully, you'll hear some pizzicato, two pizzicato, or two plucks, plump, plump. That is the head falling into the basket. So we listen to what I consider a shocker, the fourth movement of the Symphonie Fantastique, simply brilliant sounding though.
Thank you.
different than the Beethoven. I thought I'd read you just a couple quotes before we go to the last movement. Fétis was, François-Joseph Fétis, was a very prominent music historian, critic who attended the first performance and wrote, "The audience thought it was having a nightmare." Luigi Cherubini, the director of the Conservatoire, not a fan of Berlioz, was not in attendance and said with his accent, "There is no need to go see how not to write the music." We have one paper that said, "The terrible fracas which is still punishing the vaults of the conservatory." Another, "The most bizarre monstrosity one can possibly imagine." And later on, Rossini didn't hear a performance, but he looked through the score and he said, "What a good thing it isn't music." But there were those that did appreciate it. As I've said often in the past, I would love to have been there to see the reaction of the faces of the people hearing this. And even more so for the last movement, which gets even nastier than this one. Now we're at a Witch's Sabbath. Witch's Sabbath occurs four times a year by tradition, and it's a great gathering of demons and sorcerers and witches overseen by the devil. A lot of dancing and festivity. And in Berlioz's version, we have the young artist appearing and also the beloved. But now the beloved is transformed into this dreadful witch, and transformed also is her theme. It's almost unrecognizable. He throws in a lot of grace notes, little notes before the regular notes of the tune, trills. He vulgarizes it. It makes her sound very nasty. And literally all hell breaks out in this movement. So I think we'll listen to it in its entirety. And it's a wonderful noise.
Thank you. Thank you.
would think that that would be the end of it. But it's not the end. And let me play you what happens next.
Dieu, je vis encore.
What was that? Berlioz wrote a sequel. Not too many people know about this. After he wins the Grand Prix de Rome, he goes to Rome for almost 2 years. He writes a sequel to the Symphonie Fantastique. That is The Artist Who's Awakening, because all of this has been a bad dream. And in this next piece, which is called Lelio, it's a combination of narration and singing and orchestra. He's at one time a brigand, another time he's a conductor. But it's wonderful when you have this monstrous ending to the symphony and then this figure who says, God, I'm still alive. Anyway, I think that's it for today. Maybe some questions. I left a lot out, unfortunately. But maybe a good question will allow me to use that which was left out.